Dias, Prachur Dias, and I am really thankful for Dr. Hema for inviting me to guest lecture on this issue on global sourcing platform. Dr. Hemalatha is a friend of mine who has done, I mean, when we were doing the in the management studies and in Madurai Community University, and she has pioneered in a lot of fields, and she has been a backbone in mending all her project reports and all our studies into a larger extent, wherein we excelled. So to start with, I have started my career way back in 1996 when I finished my academics from Anna University in Applied Geology. I've done my master's in Applied Geology, and I started to touch rocks. And after that, I even started to do something in marketing when I stepped into Madurai Community University to do my master's in marketing. And after that, I did my real value marketing for about a year. Again, rocks did not let me go loose, so it engulfed me. And right now it's like over two decades now, I've been with the rocks for up and down in my life, running along with it. Moreover, I love the rocks, and it has given me a better upliftment in my life personally, as well as family-wise, and it's all good. So rocks has done a very important thing in my life. Well, to start with, natural resources. Natural resources let us take natural resources as in granite, because natural resources, there are a lot of different natural resources in our earth, right? From granite, from marble, from travertine, from limestone, from pavement building blocks, and from gravel. Everything is natural resources. But for our terminology, let us go with granite, the terminology. So these are all like natural resources which can be found in mountains, underneath the earth surfaces, wherein this is getting mined with a large, big machinery involved as huge blocks. These blocks come in big cubes like loaf of bread. So these rocks, which are getting excavated from the earth, or being transported to the nearby factories, wherein they're cut into slices of granite slabs. Normally, the dimensions of a granite slab is roughly around 10 feet by 9 feet in length. And it is more similar to a wall of our regular sized room. So that big will be one slab. So these are then marketed based on their surface finishes. Surface finishes may be from polishing, or it might take leather finish, or there is something like sandblasting techniques which is involved, or that can also be flame for not to be slippery on the ground. So it takes a lot of finishes, but for us, let us keep it with the polishing for our better understanding. Because granites, in the layman sense, knows much more than if we say natural resources. So granite is very unique in a lot of different ways, right from its patterns, right from its colors, shades, texture, tonality, tensile strength, hardness, density, everything. It is very, very much in a greater goodness of this granite. So granite, how it got succeeded in the market is only by the cycle of the humans. For example, take me for an instance. If I want to buy a car, I won't be buying a car immediately. I'll be seeing what is there with my neighbor, or what is the car that is fast selling. So if I'm going to see my neighbor's car, do you think that I'm going to buy the same car as my neighbor? No, I'm buying the same car. I'll be buying a different car, different model. Of course, with the same price, maybe the price might be the same, but it will be different, at least in the shade or in the color, it will be different. So I want it to be like unique. I don't want it to be identical with what others have. So this small human psychology made its way in granite, because why I'm saying this example is granite, no two blocks or no two slabs will be identical in each other, because granite has various textures. It will be amorphous, will be massive, will have different minerals, mineral pockets in it, will have a different shades and different varieties in nature, different colors, right from blue, right from black, yellow, orange, browns, blue, I mean, like, you know, pearls, glittery, everything will be there in the nature. So that makes it very unique, and it has made its way into the kitchen counters of regular household. Kitchen counters are the main winning thing is, like, ladies who use the kitchen. So they prefer to be very unique in their kitchens. So kitchen counters, why do they prefer granite counters? In the sense, like, it is very harder, it is very non-porous, so it can bear the weight, it can withstand the heat of the kitchen, and it can even the polished surfaces, it doesn't fade out that easily. Even with the help of a kind of small detergent, light detergent, like Colin, what you use in your household, it doesn't fade out that easily. So kitchen counters, granite, if you're going to use it, it's going to be for them for a quite longer period of time. Normally, granites, when they're cut in international market, they're cut into two different thickness. One is like 3 centimeter in thickness, and the other one will be like 2 centimeter in thickness. Generally, 3 centimeter thickness make its way to the kitchen counters because of its thickness. It can withstand the heat and the weight, as I was telling you something back. So this is this one thing is there. And then for the 2 cm, it finds its way to the backsplashes of the kitchen. Supposing, for instance, if the kitchen, one household uses Black Galaxy as a kitchen counter, the same color has to be used as a backsplash for them to match the color. So accordingly, the granite count, the 3 cm slab can find its way in the kitchen counters and in islands in the dining hall. Similarly, some of the other classifications, like, as I was telling you, travertine and limestone, it can find its way in the bathrooms and in sinks, around the sinks, because it won't be that much slippery, and so people can walk easily in the bathroom floors. So that finds its way. Granite also takes its own different, as I was telling you, it can take different surface finishes, right from flaming, right from sandblasting. So these have a lot of different uses in different segments in a household. So being said this, so now, next product, this being. So now, how is a product being successful in the market? Yeah, in a market, the product to be, rather than for granted, for any product for that to say, there are 3 R's to be very importantly noted. Right price, right quality, and at right time. So a product to be successful has to be brought at the right price, and the quality of the product has to be pakka. It should not, like, you know, be in a different way. It should be a right quality. And the timing of the quality of the product has to be at the right time. It has to be at the marketing. It should be in the hands of the marketing people for them to market the product. So these things are very important for the granite to flourish. Granite normally is available in all over the globe, but the main portion of the globe, which is very much available, will be from the Brazil, from India, from Italy, from Spain, from Turkey, from Norway, from Sweden, very, very. But the major source of granite is from Brazil. So Brazil, why I'm saying is, like, almost like 70% of the granite comes from Brazil. It has got different types of material, right? To name some commercial names, I can say Typhoon Bordo, Peacock Green, Sienna Bordo, Green Peak, and Green Butterfly, to name a few, Azul Platino. All is based on the colors, the tonal structures, the mineral assemblages, what they have. So in Brazil, they mine, it has got, like, it is very similar to Indian tropical climate, and even the people behavior is the same like in India. And say in some years back, during 2016 or 2017, I'm not sure about the age, about the years, during that time, in Brazil, the political scenario was in such a way that the government relaxed a lot of rules, and then it sanctioned a lot of industries to come up, to raise up their industrial level. So they leveraged a lot of money to flow in from the banks. So that made a lot of industries to come up in a mushroom segment. So when I visited Brazil in 2016, I was able to see almost like 500 to 600 units that has come up within a span of like 3 or 4 months, a lot of industries. So what happened in this time? Demand was there, but again, the supply was greater than the demand. So what happened was, these industries which was producing the same goods of granite were forced to sell those granite at a cheaper price than they were selling it before. So this made, see, one time we used to buy the granite in per square feet ratio in dollars. So some of the products of granite, what we buy from Brazil, which we bought by $20 per square feet, we were able to buy at $5 to $6 per square feet because of this trend. Of course, with the small minor defects in the quality, but it is non-negotiable. It is very, very, very much in place. We can take it. So why I'm saying this example is, we also have to understand the political structure of a country or a nation where we are buying from. Based on that, the price will differ. We need to be very advanced, and this can be done only with the rapport that we will be having along with the industry, national people, and suppliers around the globe. And also the same thing, what we need to understand is the dollar fluctuations that will happen in any country. So if the dollar is something fluctuating, if you're going to buy it in local currency, we can save a lot of money, and then that will definitely trigger the margin of the company that what we work with. So Brazil, by being said this, so right time, right price is the one that we used to buy. So we need to negotiate the quality, the product at a pace where the price will be worthy for us to make some very good margin, and with the profit will be in a better way. So how we can do? Supposing if the same product that's coming to the location, supposing if you're going to buy at $5 price, and the landed cost will be around $2 per square feet, the landed price of the same product will be like $7 when it lands to the warehouse. So if you're going to put 25% margin, including the overheads, the warehouse cost, and the salary of the people that who are working with, if you're going to pick all this stuff, then we should be selling at a very comfortable rate of like $10 to $11 in the market. But the competitor, if he is going to sell it at $9 per square feet, then we are stuck. We don't know. This is not going to go in the market. But we need to understand how the competitor can sell at this price when we can buy only at this $5 price. There are several factors involving in this. One of the major important thing is logistics. The competitor might be having a leasing factory, which is very close to the quarrying operation. The logistics might be saved in that point of time. Or the competitor might be having his own company, wherein the production cost might be reduced to a larger extent so that they can sell it at a different price segment to cater his needs and to garner his market share. So these things has to be taken into account. And how this can happen is only when we are going to the extensive study and research in the market, by traveling to all the different places, and if you're going to have good friends around our circle, we can understand this trend and we can accordingly buy it. There are also pricing terms what we can discuss. For example, your product is selling very good in the market. See, if you're going to buy a product that can be sold within like 1 month, then 30 days we can sell the product off. So, and you replenish the product. We don't have to buy that in terms in the sense that we can buy it to 90 days or 180 days terms. We don't have to buy in that sense. If you're going to pay in cash, we can definitely concentrate on the pricing. We can buy it at a very good price, and we can buy it in a huge quantity, and we can rotate the money. Money will be rotated, and we can generate different revenue from that color or from that shape. So these are the things that we need to understand when we are sourcing it globally from other country and from other nations. From India, if you say the pockets of India where we can buy granite is from Tamil Nadu, from Andhra Pradesh, from Rajasthan, from Uttar Pradesh. These are the four main regions where I can source granite from. And some of the commercial material, to name a few, will be black obsidian, which many of you might have been known about this color, and black galaxy, when there are some golden specks in the black, it's called black galaxy, and whites like Viscon white, colonial white, and from north states, northern states such as fantasy brown, some different sides of golden brown is there, which is called as blue dunes by its name, commercial name. These are the things that we are getting from India, and it is getting sourced locally, and we are also selling it. I mean, almost like Indian share is like 30% of the whole market or the whole globe. So we are doing from India as well. So, and the quality I meant, right quality is definitely international quality is something which we need to make sure the quality happens in every container that we used to buy. The quality is very strict in international segment, from the thickness, from the size of the slab, from the curvature of the slab. It has to be exactly similar to the specifications what we get from the clients. If there is something different in the structure or in the dimensions of the slab, then the container gets rejected just like that. They don't care about anything, not unless. So I would be making more concentration on the quality products to be bought at the right price and with the negotiable quality. This is very important. And right time in the sense, why I said right time is, supposing we are booking a container from India, generally it takes for the shipping line from the time of booking, it takes around 2 months or 55 days in short to say, to reach the port of US. And to reach the hands of the location where we are sending the container, it takes another 1 week. So 2 months will take for a container to ship from Indian port to US port, US destination. So this 2 months time has to be notified to the marketing team well in advance, so that the marketing team might be very very much known. They know to say to their clients and to sell their products at a very good time frame and a very good price. So this is very important for the time of the shipment. For this, we need to have a very good tie-up with the shipping line agencies, shipping liners, and some of the shipping liners are like MSC, Hapag-Lloyd, Mediterranean. All these things has to have a very good rapport for us to have a very good pricing and to have a right time to be sent across to the locations. And in marketing point of view, if you say, for example, you might be understanding this term FIFO, which is called first in and first out. This is very important in today's modern era, because if you're going to buy a container at one point of time, the marketing segment, marketing people who are there at the locations has to sell this material before the next material comes in. So even if the next material comes in, they shouldn't open it, but first sell this first, the old inventory, and then they need to touch that new inventory that is coming into play. This way, the books are all cleared, and the books are all very much in a neat form and in a very clear form, so that there won't be any hassles in maintaining the records. So the old inventory has to be sold. For example, if you're going to buy a container with 50 slabs in it, 40 slabs are sold and 10 slabs are left behind in the warehouse, and another container came in with a new set of product. So if he is going to leave this 10 slab and open the new container without selling this 10 slab, what's going to happen? This 10 slab will be sitting in this warehouse. It cannot be sold when the new product is open. So this is going to eat the profit what has been earned by the 40 slabs. Then ultimately what's going to happen is it is going to stay there for about a time period of about 6 months to 1 year, And then finally, we need to liquidate it at no profit and loss. So that should not happen if you're going to follow the term FIFO, first in and first out. The second thing, what I wanted to stress is the reordering level or reordering quantity. In modern days, right now, the ERP tools, which almost all the companies will be having it by this right now, they'll be having it. So enterprise resource management, ERM tools, every tools will be having this reordering quantity level being built up as a tool in that, in the system. What does it do? It just measures the sales done over a period of time. We can give that period of time. Maybe it might be a quarter, maybe it might be a 6 months, maybe it might be like a year. So based on the feedback that we are giving, it just calculates the quantity that is needed for the next 6 months or next quarter, what is needed for them to suffice their inventory level to maintain at the level. So based on the reordered quantity, we can then source the material from different suppliers, from our known sources at a right price and at right time. So next is the just-in-time. Just-in-time is also very important, and this very clearly envisages the logistics part of the buying process. So this the logistics part has to be secured in such a way that the team who works in the logistics area has to monitor very precisely about the movement of the ships, about the movement of the containers, about their dates of movement, where it is stuck. If it is stuck somewhere, then he need to immediately inform the sales management or the sales team that this container has been stuck somewhere, so that they can immediately inform their clients, so that the clients do not move out somewhere instead of giving false promises. They can track, and then they can keep the containers ready, so they cannot lose their clients. So just in time is also plays a very important part in management role and principles. So these three things, FIFO, reordering level, just in time. These three, what we theoretically read in Granite, I mean in management, has proved to be a very important tool in the modern era of management. And for any business to succeed, new product development is very important to sustain their business activity in their marketing trend. So new product, what does that mean by new product is? Either it might be from the same Granite, for example, Granite, what we get from Granite from Brazil, we would have bought from Africa as well. That is one thing. Otherwise, different, I mean, a little bit different. Like right now, for example, what I wanted to say is, new product that is emerging globally is artificial man-made stone, which is finding its way in the international arena in a big way. It is man-made, it is artificial, but what it is, the raw material is the mined rocks, like quartz rocks. They used to mine it, they crush it, pulverize it, and then they make in a template with a kind of massive resin, which is laid on a template, and then they build in a various different designs and different models of this artificial stone. This is very similar. They have built in such a way that it is very similar to granite, what we used to buy, in their density, in their brittleness, in their tonality. Everything is there. One thing, the positive thing of this artificial granite is it is very, very uniform. If you are going to lay in a 10,000 square feet area on the surface of the room or the hall, it is going to be uniform everywhere. I mean, like all the whole area will be uniform. It has got like warm colors, neutral colors, very nice colors. It is very nice to see if it is very uniform in its segment. So that has proved to be a winning color, winning classification in this marketing trend in the Western countries. People love to have this kind of uniformity. Of course, artificial stone has its own thing, A natural stone has its own aesthetic value, being a natural stone, which is mined from the earth, which is very natural, and that has its own value. But again, equally important and equally growing is this artificial stone, which is also finding its way in a lot of countries. Even in India, in Bangalore, you can see a lot of places where this quartz stone has been used and which has been being used right now. So this one, by being said that, this quartz is going to be like earlier when it was introduced somewhere around 2 years back, it introduced very, very slowly from China, it got entered. So after China started this market, it found its way in Western countries, and it was in the region of like around 20% artificial stone versus 80% of granites. It was in such a way. And slowly it gained entry, and right now it is somewhere around 40 to 60% market share. So 40% is artificial stone, whereas 60% is natural stone. It is still eating. It might even come to 70 and 30. Trend changes. And again, it will be changing the other way also. Market definitely, it doesn't diminishes in any sense. And this product, that what I'm saying, to develop this product, it involves huge investment in the sense, right from gathering samples, distributing pamphlets, conducting roadshows, conducting a lot of fabricator meets, investor meets, and display segments. I mean, it involves a lot of different things for this product to be promoted. Of course, part of it is being promoted by the source from where we used to buy, and part of it is being sourced by our company, which we are promoting the product as our product. So both go hand in hand. So this product development is very important. And again, important is the supply chain development. From the lot of contacts that I have built up, or for that reason, for anyone who has built the product, the shades of the product is very important and very crucial in determining the market trends. For example, if you are going to buy a product with a certain shade, for example, from Brazil, there is a color named ornamental. Ornamental has a different shade. Some might be oranges, some might be like yellowish in color. So some people prefer yellowish, some people will prefer orangish. So we need to understand which product, which client needs which shade. And accordingly, we can streamline with the supplier. We can buy only that shade. So that supply chain we need to develop after in a due course of time. And that has to be stabilized with our company for a long time to grow. So both this has to go in hand in hand. So being said that, China, when we were doing a lot of business with China, like in 2 years back, we did a lot of business with China. And after Trump government, politically, there were a lot of unstable with their with the US part of with against China. So they implied a lot of taxes, which is very high, which nobody can bear the brunt of it. And so almost all companies stopped buying from China. And what happened was those suppliers which we want to buy were all diverted to other Mid-East countries, spanning Vietnam, Malaysia, Thailand, SAR countries, and even from the Korea, from Malaysia. I mean, like, you know, all these SAR countries we started to procure the material from. So hopefully the situation might turn different with the new government in place in US, and hopefully that China might be opening their gates of business wide open to US. Being said that, thanks for being with me. And this is my short lecture on this topic. Thank you.
Thank you, Suresh. Maybe we will open this forum for questions. Maybe you can share your experience. So as a management department, we are curious to know about any particular cultural difference when you are sourcing from various countries as a management student? Suppose if they are placed in and managing this kind of businesses, what they are supposed to do?
Main thing, what from our Indian point of view, we need to understand their language. You know, for example, if you're going to go to Brazil, of course we cannot learn Spanish or Portugal, but at least, you know, we need to make sure that we are okay with how we are treating people, how they're to understand the behavioral aspects of Brazilians. For example, Brazilians are very friendly, are very transparent, are very open-minded. So you have to, when you're going to buy material from them, you got to especially clearly explain to them what you need and what price you're targeting it, so that they can understand your needs, and then they can provide you all the means and sources from where you can buy it from. If you're going to buy it from China, again, it's the same thing. Quality consciousness is very important for the US market. So we need to diversify the quality that what we need, the dimensions of what we need. Without that, we cannot buy. We need to say them up front so that they can understand, and then they can do it in a rational way.
Yeah, thank you. What kind of technical tools you are using it at the time of maybe all ERP or maybe out when you are connecting with various countries and clients? What kind of tools and techniques you follow so that that is easy for you to weigh and see which is the best? Maybe
ERP tool, what we use right now is, it is called like Stone Profit Solutions. It's widely used in Western countries with all the stone industry. They use this software. In this software, you have different tools, such as I was telling you about reordering quantity, which definitely works on the sales forecasting model, and it gives a complete picture of what to buy at when the inventory level falls below a certain level, and when the sales forecast says that it is moving well in the market, that this reordering quantity gives us an idea, and it gives us a picture of what to buy immediately or what to place immediately, so that it can come at a point of time. So this is very helpful when we are ordering the material with all the global sources. And again, all this ERP software that what we are using is all like, has an inbuilt emailing system, wherein when we are going to place a purchase order, it goes straight to the purchase, the supplier where we buy it from. And those suppliers can easily track the purchase order, and then they can produce the material, and they can upload those pictures of the material that what they are producing, along with their invoices and packing lists, in the same ERP tool. We can easily pull out this invoice and packing list from our ERP system, what the suppliers have done. And again, the pictures that what they are uploading, it is live. For example, the bundles on the granite part of view, I'm saying the bundles what they are uploading in the ERP system will be live in our system. So when the salesman goes to meet the clients, he would be having Malay an iPad or a small tool where he can see the material. He can just see the material, what is there. I mean, like, you know, in a live. So he can sell the material. If he is going to sell a bundle or two bundle or a container, he can just plug it in there, like this material is currently sold. So this container, the picture will go from the live. So otherwise cannot see the material in the software. So this is very helpful, so that no doubling of activity will take place.
Yeah, thank you. Do you think the marketing strategy, what you follow in bulk sourcing, right? And specifically these granite products, is it going to be different from the other product? Is anything unique in it? Or maybe I'll put in the other way, that what kind of skill set you expect a person to handle while working in this granite business?
See, product is product. That way I can tell you. But only thing that is different is to understand the nature of the product. That is very important when any marketing person who is going to come into the play. If you can understand the product nature and the names of the product, that would be very helpful for him to to market the product in his sales territory. Understanding the product in a sense, I don't want him to go deep into the geology or structure of the earth or anywhere, nothing like that. I'm telling something about, you know, the name of the product, how, what is the dimension, what is the thickness, how well is the product, the thickness of what is the product. Those kind of small information is enough for him to market a product. But basic thing, what he need to learn or learn from him when he's going to source, when he's going to market the product, is the pricing and the material name and their origin and their classification. So he cannot sell a material which is a granite as a marble. If he's going to sell as a marble, if it is a granite, if he's going to sell as a marble, then there are a lot of political things wherein the government can sue the company for renaming a product or classification in a different way. Because granite is stronger, marble is not stronger. It is porous in nature. So marble cannot be used in a granite, I mean, in a kitchen countertop, because it might be brittle. It might break easily, but not the granite. So he need to classify. The classification has to be very accurate when he's selling the product. That's why I'm saying, when any marketing person who is going to enter the marketing segment, he need to understand the basics of the product that what he is going to sell. That is very, that is an essential tool for a marketing guy in this environment.
Thank you, Suresh. I'll leave it to the other audience to ask a few questions.
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Vasant Kumar speaking, yes. Department of Industrial Engineering and Management. As a marketing professional, how do you see the future of these granites? And what is the competitive, strong competitive alternate materials that could replace the granites? And number two, the second question is, it is a natural resource. Is there any way to replenish it? Because it gets depleted. How do you see the future? There could be complete depletion of this resource, or and it could be a very strong alternate material that could replace this.
Yeah, thanks for asking, Mr. Vasant Kumar. First thing, when you're seeing about the marketing of this material, definitely the marketing is not going to go down. There are new products that is coming up right now in the market. As I was telling you, the quartz product, which is man-made and which is very equally stronger and denser in terms of granite, is making its way in the market. So that's a new product that is coming up into the picture. It is not going to go that easily out of the market segment. And second thing, the replenishing you are saying, this thought of replenishing was there when I was doing the granite industry, when I was starting the granite industry 20 years back. Till now, the market hasn't depleted. It is still continuously coming up. There is no, I mean, any industry when you're starting with, there is no question of depleting or replenishing. If one product goes away, the other products come up into the question, come up in a different quarry. So the color changes. Of course, the color changes, not it will be, it won't be the same as you're acquiring in the mine, what we are doing it before, but the shade, but there will be another quarry, another color of the same dimension of the same structure as it was before, will be in a different texture will be there. So there won't be any depleting of the quarry. Even if it is, India is slow in the region of mining, it can be excavated from different sources of the other parts of the earth. They can mine it easily.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. If there are any questions from the participant side, please unmute your mic. I have given access to unmute your mic yourselves. Hope there are any other questions. Yeah. Over to you, madam.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Suresh Babu, for exchanging your views and then sharing your knowledge with us and your experience. And we just visualized how your business is now. And, you know, like how we are moving around with the people from various countries and then what is very important with reference to this marble and granite business. And That makes some sense. Like each industry gives a different insights for us. So first and I think after a long time, we are seeing something different in our industry as an industry experience. Thank you very much for sharing it. Thank you one and all. Maybe we'll move on to the next session. Thank you very much, Suresh, for coming forward and sharing your experience.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for being with me for this time. Yeah. And for listening patiently with me. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
sir. Now we can log out and join the next session. So individual session links will be provided to you in the WhatsApp group. Accordingly, you can join. Thank you.
Thank you.